100 years ago, James Cook set forth from England to seek an enticing new land called Terra Australis, upon which to plant the flag. To emulate the tradition set by the early empire builders, intrepid Englishmen follow to the Antipodean colony to this very day.
Stand up all day.
Excuse me, sir. I must here first. Excuse me, sir.
There you are. I hope you're satisfied. Now we've both missed it. There's nothing I'd enjoy less now than standing up here, getting burnt to a cinder. I don't know. There are times when I really think that not every Englishman is worthy of carrying a Britannic Majesty's passport. Look at them. Rolling about there. A whole nation of sitters. That's what's become of us. Makes you wonder about evolution. If the human body develops those parts that get the most use, well, I'd like to be in England in a couple of hundred years and I'd put my money in seat covers. That's all that's left of the bulldog spirit, as far as most people are concerned. Of course, we Hancocks have always been a seafaring race. If it hadn't been a question of time, I'd have sailed across single-handed. But life's too short to fit everything in. It's all right for Sir Francis Chichester, but I've got too much on my plate. I've got to help build up a new country. After all, Captain Cook didn't arrive single-handed, did he? I wonder if Matilda's still waltzing around with that kangaroo.
Well, Hancock, I thought you might like a pint.
Have you any idea what time it is?
It's about 6 o'clock. That'd make it 10 o'clock in London. And in Hong Kong...
It is the cocktail hour, and you bring me a pint of crudely iced beer wearing what I can only describe as totally informal dress. At the cocktail hour, be it in Bombay or Brixton, people should be properly attired.
Just because you've only got one suit.
As we near your former home in the Antipodes, Mervyn, I deduce signs of you getting above yourself. Remember, you've been in Britain for the past 6 years, and our influence throughout the world is built upon a tradition of observing social rituals such as the cocktail hour. Now, kindly go and get properly dressed.
It's no good living in the past, Hancock. They won't put up with all that class bit over there.
Oh, won't they? Huh. We'll soon see about that. Oh, yes. See this? I'll have you know this is a British passport. Have you ever read what it says inside?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Her Britannic Majesty's Principal Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs requests and requires
In the name of Her Majesty, all those who it may concern, to allow the bearer to pass freely without let or hindrance, and to afford the bearer such assistance and protection as may be necessary.
Like to hear you read that mouthful if you're in a punch-up in Wagga.
You're forgetting, Mervyn, the guards never retreat. Well, as it's nearing the end of cocktail hour, salute, so we go. Don't think much of that. Ugh. Oh, it's ridiculous the way they're handing round cards with our position and altitude on.
Look, that's only on aeroplanes.
Oh, well, depth, position of icebergs and other natural hazards.
More than likely is handing out invitations for the captain's dinner. This is the last night at sea, and they always invite anyone who hasn't dined with them so far.
Ah, that's a point. I'll have to get changed. I wonder whether I should wear the tails or the MCC blazer.
Hello there! Making the most of your last day at sea?
Oh, yes, hello there. Yes, nothing like the old dozer.
Oh, no!
I hear it's fried seagull again tonight.
Oh!
The captain's favorite, eh?
Oh, no, it's a bit special. Huh? What with having to select the 2 millionth migrant.
Ah, yes.
It's quite a distinction.
Are we all eligible?
Well, originally, but there have been eliminations.
Some are automatic.
Yes, well, it's going to all going to be settled at dinner tonight.
Have you got an invitation for Mr. Hancock?
No, he's probably left it in the cabin.
Oh, dear. I'm afraid your name isn't on the list. Well, I must be getting along, you know. Lots of preparations for tonight. Oh, well, cheerio. See you later.
Yeah, bet there are.
Ah, you're not missing much. Pretty stuffy, these affairs. It's probably just an oversight.
Oh, no, it's not. It's a deliberate snub from the captain. I didn't like the look of him from the moment I set foot on board. Looks like a Greek to me. Probably got the only lifebelt on the ship stowed away under his bed. No doubt I have been a little outspoken on his handling of the ship. But there aren't enough people these days who will speak their minds. Risk their future. Too many people are content to hide behind the organization. It is the age of the anonymous man, and I am not anonymous.
As far as the captain's concerned, you are.
No matter. Be that as it may, I shall have to use my own initiative. Make my own plans. A small soiree in my cabin. Just an intimate affair.
Who with?
Well, who better than Miss Bancroft over there? A splendid example of feminine pulchritude.
Do you want us to dress formally?
Well, just wear your white jacket, you know, that one you bought at the Army and Navy surplus stores.
And Miss Bancroft?
As much as I admire her curvaceous grace and slimline beauty, I must insist that on this occasion she is fully clothed.
I shall issue the invitation formally, immediately.
Aye, aye, Mr. Mervyn. I said all along the wrong man was running this ship. I bet Captain Bligh had a bigger cabin than this. That's the trouble of being a 10-pound migrant. They take advantage of you. I expected at least a stateroom. After all, they want me out there. Oh, yes, they need people like me out there. It's lucky my great-grandfather, Admiral Hancock, isn't alive to see this. He'd have a fit. A seafaring personage like myself confined to a dog kennel like this? It's a wonder they didn't put me in chains or lash me to the mizzenmast or a funnel or whatever they do these days. No, it's coming up for 7 bells. I better get changed.
Hancock? Hancock?
Yeah.
I delivered the invitation. Slipped it under Miss Bancroft's door.
Good, good.
Oh, hold on, I'll give you a hand.
Be careful, careful. It's a very choice piece of clobber.
Oh, yeah.
That's more like it.
Oh. MCC, when did you work for the Manchester City Corporation?
The Manchester... This is the Marylebone Cricket Club. You've heard of Typhoon Tyson? You're looking at Hurricane Hancock. We're very proud of this badge in my family. I'm sure it will impress Miss B.
Yes.
Come on, that's
very impressive.
That's better.
We need another chair.
No, you won't have time to sit down. Just get the table laid. Right. Now then, what shall we have? Let's see. Shall we have
No card? Or Land of Hope and Glory?
I prefer Ralph Harris.
Yes, you would.
Where would you like Miss Bancroft to sit?
Over there under the porthole. Lit from behind, she would look a rare beauty. I shall be able to view her more easily.
Mervyn, I needn't stress too strongly that I'm relying on your discretion this evening. I'm sure you'll know when the moment has come in which to make a discreet exit. And if you don't sense it, you'll get a good 3 inches of pointed patent leather in your posterior. Hold. Listen to that gentle knock.
Oh, Hancock, you're that romantic.
There's only Keats and Shelley and me left. Open the door, Mervyn. I think you've got the wrong cabin.
Oh, how sweet. I got your invitation. Nearly missed it, though. It got jammed under the door.
It is Miss Bancroft.
That's right, but my friends call me Bunny, actually.
Is it your daughter, the one in the bikini on the sun deck?
Oh, no. I gather we've got the same name, but that's all we share in common.
You do not exaggerate.
Do we sit or stand for aperitif?
Mervyn.
Oh, is this the moment when you want me to leave you?
No, you fool. We want the aperitifs.
Aperitifs? What's
sherry,
that?
Sherry. That's all we've got, the sherry. Do sit down, Miss Bancroft.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Hancock.
You must excuse my man.
I will take a little sherry tonight, too, please, Mervyn.
Oh, but there's only 2 glasses.
There are only 2 of us dining.
Only the other night?
Yes?
I was dining with the captain.
How very nice for you.
Such a charming man.
Yes, I wish he'd spend less time eating and more time in directing the boat.
He's got such an appetite. Brilliant man. Leads such an exciting life.
You call that exciting? They're nothing more or less than glorified bus drivers. They should be on ferries, if you ask me, all this business about dining with them.
You haven't dined with him, Mr. Hancock.
No, it's a mere oversight, a slip of the purser's pen.
It must be very exciting up there tonight.
Yes. I wonder who'll win the 2 millionth migrant award.
You make it sound like a cattle show.
Now, when you think about it, it's really a very great honor to be the 2 millionth migrant into this country.
Imagine letting a man like that pick the 2 millionth migrant. We all know what the captain's cabin's like, don't we? I mean, we're all adults. That's where the final decision will be made.
I gather he has a rather nice cabin.
Yes, old chintz and wallpaper, I suppose. Not like Nelson. They don't make captains like Nelson anymore.
Poor man.
That's the last thing he is.
No, I mean Nelson. Such a frail, sensitive person.
My mother always said I looked like him.
It's the column you look like, mate, not the man. The captain's a fool. He hasn't got enough experience. Steady on, Mervyn. Are you sure Miss Bancroft's had enough? You're not serving at the captain's table now, you know.
Oh, that's quite all right, Mr. Hancock.
Oh, I'm so sorry. They have to be trained from birth, otherwise it's useless.
That's good. If you don't eat your duck now, it will return to its original frozen condition.
Duck? Duck? Who wanted duck? Perhaps Miss Bancroft would have fancied a filet mignon or a filet de bœuf en croûte. What say you to that, Miss Bancroft?
Oh, no. Duck will do me fine.
That's good, because it's duck or nothing.
Not bad.
The tin foil gets on your fillings a bit, doesn't it?
Good job you had them all done for nothing before you left.
That's the point. Do you think that the 2 millionth migrant gets free medical treatment?
Why, do you think he'd need it?
From now to now and again, you know, like cholera, typhoid, things like that. The sort of disease is as common as the cold where we're going.
Oh, I always understood it to be a very healthy country.
Yes, possibly it is, but it's the places we pass through on the way that weaken you.
Well, I do think that good health would be a prerequisite for the winner of the competition, along with all the other attributes of a typical British man or woman. Dignity, humility, helpfulness. The cultured, sophisticated sort. No doubt they've been keeping their eye on all of us during this voyage.
I think there's been a slight misunderstanding.
Oh?
I was merely trying to help my fellow passengers. Perhaps there's some little thing I could do to help you. Anything, you know, just a question of goodwill, friendship, anything at all, no matter how menial the task, as long as we make the voyage a success.
Well, if you really want to help, follow me.
Thank you.
Do you know who it was?
It was the bandsman. That's right, it was the bandsman. It wasn't the captain at all.
I can't tell you how nice it is to have found somebody of my own intellectual level.
So I still stand a chance. The prize is still open. The cup can still overflow with success.
Oh, yes. You are by no means past your prime. And you're going to a new country.
He still sees himself as the 2 millionth migrant.
Oh, dear.
I'm not the first man not to be recognized in his own lifetime. Van Gogh. Robert Louis Stevenson, who invented the rocket. Look what we did to the Germans, and look where they are today.
I agree. It's scandalous.
He's just jealous.
It's all right for you, but you didn't suffer.
You didn't put a lifetime's work into a bed of prize marrows, only to have them bombed to bits by the Hun.
Oh, I just love marrow, especially in Jesus.
Bet you just get used to these setbacks when you're ahead of your time.
It's all this crossing the international date line. It upsets us all.
Oh, is it Monday or Tuesday?
No matter, tomorrow is another day. A new land. Man is never recognized in his own country. Even his ship is registered in London. That's the prejudice. All this fuss over the 2 millionth migrant. I find it all rather plebeian, really. Rather in for a dig. Who wants their pictures in the papers anyway? There you are, smiling away 1 minute, and the next you're being used as a wrapper for fish and chips. Enough of my worries. The ramblings of a genius aren't to everybody's taste. Miss Bancroft. I apologize, madam. I'm neglecting you, dear lady. Mervyn, more coffee. Let's splice the main brace and have 4 lumps of sugar.
Oh, that's rather fattening.
No matter. Let's lash it out. It's the last night at sea. Sorry. There we are. It's the last night at sea, the journey of a lifetime.
Mr. Hancock?
Speak to him with that. Miss Bancroft is in a draft. Take a message. I'll deal with it tomorrow morning.
This is delicious coffee. I did enjoy your sherry.
Yes, you had a go at that, didn't you?
Yes, I did. Yes.
The captain requests the pleasure of your company at his cabin. He wants you to join him and the other Miss Bancroft there.
Was that the captain without?
No, it's his right-hand man.
I only speak to commanding officers. You should know that by now.
But, Hancock, this might be about the... You know.
If the captain wishes to call on me, I shall be in my quarters. That is, if Miss Bancroft here gives me permission to digress from our social pleasures for a moment. Oh.
Lovely coffee.
Yes. Well?
He just said if you are not interested, he can't wait around all night.
Yes. I'd better get up above. If the mountain won't come to Mahomet...
Oh! Permission. I insist you stay, you darling man.
Yes, Miss Bancroft, thank you very much. It's been most delightful.
Oh, thank you, most enjoyable. Yes.
It's the best night you've ever had at sea.
I thought there might be some little way I might show my appreciation.
You're going to be the 2 millionth migrant. What happened in the captain's cabin last night?
Well, we found we had a great deal in common, our interest in cricket. I found him very adaptable, very malleable.
And corrupt.
Shh, here he comes.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As you are now tied to the pier of what is to become your new home, the moment has arrived to choose the person who will represent you all and all who have come before you. Now, after very careful consideration, we have reduced the field to Miss Felicia Bancroft. Anthony Hancock. Now, these two finalists did not intrude. They went about their business carefully considering their fellow passengers. Mr. Hancock, in particular, was most restrained. And it was this attribute, I think, that finally swayed the judges. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2 millionth migrant, Mr. Anthony Hancock. Now, the press will be very, very patient. They're waiting outside. Would you ask them to come in, Mr. Fellows?
Thank you. Continue my story about Lords. When I was bowling, Australia were 800 for two. Bradley was on, you know, and I was bowling my googly, actually.
Ladies and gentlemen, our 2 millionth migrant.
Thank you. I'm very proud of you.
No, you've got the wrong one.
Thank you.
I'd just like to say how very proud I am to be the 3 millionth migrant.
It's not her. It's not her.
It's A-N-T-H-O-N-Y.
Look, mate. I've got another mate. You don't think I'm carrying this lot for nothing, do you? I'm not a Bedouin Arab, though under this lot I might slightly resemble a beast of burden.
They're very helpful. Hardly open a case.
Well, after all, we are British.
Of course, they're really after the big boys. Men with 1,000 watches strapped around their waist. Girls with gold tucked in their bras.
Can that really be all her? These customs officers must live some very interesting lives.
Hello, little man, come along.
Good morning, Mr. Hancock. What a crowd. I had quite a job to get a porter.
Typical. Never there when you do want them. And always there when you don't.
Well, these customs men might have a little modesty. Is nothing sacred from the bureaucrat these days?
I couldn't agree more. Most embarrassing, most embarrassing.
I trust they won't go through our luggage like that.
No fear of that, madam. The more mature traveller you will find is allowed through, as it states so clearly in our British passport, without let or hindrance.
Good morning, my good man. What a glorious day.
Come along there. Keep the queue moving.
Good morning. Lovely day. I bet it's still snowing in England.
Just a minute.
Were you addressing your remarks to me by any chance?
What are those books?
Just a little light reading matter. Well, a few digests, a few condensed bestsellers. I don't get the time to read like I used to.
Yes, you'd be surprised what's brought into our country under the guise of popular mechanics.
The nearest in that lot to pornography is Little Women.
Come on, open it all up.
What, all the lot?
That's right, the lot.
But you let that woman through without so much as a whisper.
We become expert character readers in our business, mate.
I shall complain to the British ambassador about this incident.
Yeah, you don't need that now. Just open the cases.
Her Britannic Majesty will be very angry. Very angry indeed. She's your queen as much as she is ours, you know. Well, I tell her what's going on in this colony. Go easy, go easy. It took me a good hour to pack all that stuff. And my uncle had to sit on it as well. And as I haven't brought him with me, how are we going to get it closed up, I do not know. Family pet.
That will have to stay in quarantine for 6 months.
Quarantine? 6 months?
No animals or livestock, either alive or stuffed, permitted in without the statutory period of quarantine. That's not my ruling, it's the government. And I'm afraid it'll cost you £5 a week to keep it.
£5 a week? Have you gone raving mad or have I? £5 a week you propose to charge me for a stuffed owl that's been in my family for a century in quarantine?
That's the law. And as a matter of fact, you're lucky not to be fined for not declaring it in the first place.
I shall definitely petition Her Majesty about this one.
Okay, I can go now. Be quick about it.
Thank you very much indeed.
You sure you wouldn't like the shirt off me back?
Oh, and by the way.
Oh, yes, now what? Welcome. Welcome.
Hotel Dumont, reception. I'm sorry, sir, we're all booked up. Migrants, you know. Yes, we get all types in here. British, Dutch, German.
Cypriots.
I am sorry, sir, some other time, perhaps.
Good afternoon. I was wondering.
Well?
I believe you have a reservation in my name. Name is Hancock.
Hancock.
Yes, that's right. Straight off the packet, as you might say. Typically English, isn't it, making a voyage like this? Seafaring race we are. Yes, one sniff of the salt air in my lungs and I'm all for sending a gunboat up somebody's channel. Yes, that's the spirit that made Britain what it is today.
Precisely.
Well, isn't somebody going to take care of my luggage?
That's typical. Only in the country, 2 minutes, and they expect to be waited on hand and foot. Boy!
Boy! How does one get started? Where are all those friendly diggers who fought for us at El Alamein? I haven't heard a person as much as whistle waltz in Matilda yet. Still, at least there's some contact with the outside world.
Are you absolutely sure your shirt is white? Don't be half safe. Wash your shirt in Sudso. Remember that name, friends. Sudso, Sudso, Sudso.
I'll get a packet of that.
Hey out there, it is 2:53.
I'll get a packet of that as well.
We're helping them in their inquiries. In Parliament, the question of the attitude of British migrants was raised. The Minister for Immigration said that far too many people come to this country expecting everything to be done for them. Make your motto, get up and go, the Minister said.
Oh, get up and go, all right, mate. Right out of your wretched Antipodean colony. Politicians, they're the same the whole world over. They get up there and spout a whole load of codswallop. They've never volunteered to give up their natural-born way of life. Think of the sacrifices I've made to come here and help to put this country on its feet. And here I am, all alone in this miserable hotel, with tropical sun beating a tattoo on the roof. It's all surf and seaweed here. Oh, what have I done? How could I have left all that intellectual jousting, that verbal parry and thrust, the comradeship of one's intimate friends? Oh, woe is me. To think that this time last week I was in the ample bosom of the Rosen Crown. I bet London doesn't swing anymore now I've gone. No. It's a bit sharpish outside. Hello, Ina. Jim. Hello, Alan. Hello, Jeff. How's the missus? The usual, please, landlord.
What's the usual?
Half a tomato juice in a pint pot with a piece of lemon.
But we don't split tomato juices. You'll have to have a couple of them.
I know that. I've been coming here for 25 years. Has Jack been in?
Jack?
You know Jack, the tall bloke with the pipe, the glasses, the hat, the jacket, the trousers, the overcoat. Hello, lads. Great game at the Arsenal on Saturday, eh? See Jimmy Greaves scored another 3 tries for the Spurs. That should save him from relegation.
Relegation for the Spurs? They've been in the top 6 for the past 5 years.
Well, this time next week I shall be in the sun, leaving all you lot here, shivering away in the snow and the smog. Yes, Australia, here I come.
You're going to Australia?
Yes, that's right. I'm getting out of all this lot. Taxed out of existence. Keeping other people in free medicine. Turning rusty in all the rain. Yes, I'm off. The boat leaves from Southampton tomorrow, and as far as I'm concerned, it can't leave a second too soon.
Well, in that case, old man, you just got time to stand one last round of drinks before you go. I'll have a double of whiskey, Nat.
To set the world on fire, I just want to start a flame in your heart. Da 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 da. Oh, I hope I didn't disturb you, sir. Just arrived from the old country.
That's right, just trying to settle down quietly in pastures new.
I came over in 1946, just after the war. Married myself to an Aussie soldier. It's different, of course.
Is it?
Ah, but it's a beautiful country. Especially if you like the outdoors. We live in the outdoors.
You do?
Well, take us. We spend nearly all the summer on the beach. Have you brought your cozzy?
Your cozzy?
Your cozzy, your bathers, your bathing trunks. Oh, you must do some swimming.
I can't wait.
The beaches are beautiful. All golden rolling surf. Just like in the travel films. Of course, there are the sharks.
Sharks?
But it's the Portuguese men of war you have to watch out for. You don't know they're there, see?
I won't be there either, madam.
Well, perhaps you'll enjoy pottering around the garden. Every home has its little garden over here. We grow our own vegetables. At least we did.
What do you mean, you did?
Well, till the funnel web spiders.
Funnel web spiders?
Yeah, they're deadly poisonous. They don't have an antidote yet. They've got big, ugly bodies and short legs, and they just leap out at you.
At this rate, I can't see myself getting out of bed.
Don't want to stay here.
Why not?
Well, they overcharge for a start.
Oh, they do, do they?
Well, they don't like migrants, you see, so the manager says to hit them where it really hurts in the pocket.
Well, I suppose it's better than being got by one of those, what do you call them, funnel web spiders? Oh, what have I let myself in for? Come back, England. All is forgiven.
You want to get yourself a flat.
Would they have the kind of accommodation to which I'm accustomed?
Oh, better than that.
Well, actually, I was expecting a phone call from my embassy. They're probably fixing me up.
Well, if you get stuck, there's a friend of mine. Now, let me see, I've got a card here somewhere. Mrs. Gilroy. You never know, it might come in handy.
Oh, thank you. That's very kind. Very kind indeed. We British must stick together.
Ah, we're not strictly British anymore. We're Aussies.
It's all very well for her. The person with my breeding, my heritage, my family tree. British to the end. So they overcharge, do they? Well, a couple of tea towels and an ashtray will soon settle that account. Where did I put that card? Yes, Mrs. Gilroy.
Come on, come in.
The housemaid at the hotel recommended you.
Yes, I've been expecting you. That's right. Put all your things down.
I've been lugging this load of rubbish halfway around the world today. I've got blisters on my feet that raise me up so high I'm getting nosebleed from the altitude.
Oh, there, you poor man. Well, there's no more need for you to roam. I'm sure that you'll be quite happy living here under the same roof as me. I have the flat above.
Oh, you had me worried there for a moment.
Oh, I like to be near my tenants. See that they get every little thing they need. Oh, you remind me of my husband.
Is he upstairs?
Way upstairs. He's dead. But you're so much like him.
Well, that's a left-handed compliment if ever I heard one.
Now, no matter what time of the day or night, if there's any little thing you need, you just call out for me. I'll be right up there listening.
Yes, I can imagine. One ear up and one ear down.
Oh, I know what loneliness can do. I'm lonely myself.
I'm not surprised.
Ever since my dear Percy passed away, I've kept myself to myself.
Yes, well, I wouldn't want you to change your habits on my account, madam. Now, about this flat.
Oh, there. I'm rushing you, aren't I, Mr. Hancock? Well, never mind. I'm sure before long we'll reach a perfect understanding, and I'll be able to take something off for you. Oh, only a small discount off the rent, mind you, but it all helps.
Yes, well, can I just have a look at the flat?
Certainly. This here is the lounge room and the main living area. Now, through there is the bathroom. Hot and cold water, hand basin, shower, recess, etc. Oh, and in here is the bedroom.
Yes, well, I'll have a look at that later on.
All right. Well, there is a single in there at the moment, but you could change that at any time. It's rather compact and nice, isn't it? But I must show you the kitchen. Oh, it's got every modern built-in feature we could think of. My Percy was a real do-it-yourself marvel. Spent half his life locked up in the tool shed.
I don't blame him.
Oh, do you know, he never had a day's tuition in his life, yet he put all these gadgets in here himself. Mad on automatic whatnots he was. This kitchen is a push-button paradise, he always said.
How can two human beings suddenly seem like a crowd?
Oh, I must go and make your bed. You'll, know where I am if you need me.
Oops, you looked a bit tipsy there for a moment. Most unseemly. God bless you, ma'am. I know the trouble with landladies the whole world over is they either want to chuck you out or lock you in. This one needs a bit of watching. You can hardly blame her, I suppose. It's the old charm that does it. Now, where's old Percy's push-button paradise?
Ha ha ha!
I don't know anybody.
Is that you, Mrs. Gilroy?
Oh, it's only you. How did you find me?
The maid at the hotel.
Well, she's obviously got it in for me.
It's just that it's my first day back.
But she used to live here.
Well, all my friends have gone over to England.
Got more sense than I gave them credit for.
I should never have gone away. It's all different. I'm a stranger in my own land.
You're the sort who'd be a stranger anywhere.
That's really why I came round to see you, Hancock. You're a man of the world, an older man.
Not so much of the old, Mervyn. More mature, perhaps. I suppose I am fortunate, really. The world is my oyster. I can be at home anywhere I like. I can fit in. Adapt myself to the customs of the local natives. It's all down to the old alma mater, really. You are a good grounding of Latin and biology, and you can conquer the world.
Oh, I knew you would be able to supply me with the inspiration I need.
You've got to have the strength to cut the ties that bind. Strike out on your own. Take the bit between your teeth. Stand on your own 2 feet. Put your nose to the grindstone. And always remember, he who hesitates is lost.
Oh, Hancock, I wish I had your powers of oratory.
Now, it's hardly fair that one man should have so much. Well, Mervyn, it's a bit late for the education, but I could give you a crash course in the bulldog spirit of independence. See, the secret, my friend, is to soak up the local culture as soon as possible. Remember, this country has broken away from Mother England. It's now standing on its own 4 feet, establishing a culture of its own. Now, this we must observe. And what better way than through the most modern means of mass communication so far devised? Sit down. Yes, here we are now then. Here's the indication of the local civilization. Now we'll find what makes these people tick. The boom town with Clark Gable and Spencer Tracy. The Three Stooges meet Andy Hardy. Shirley Temple stars with Ronald Reagan and the Little General. The Marx Brothers in Duck Soup. Fay Wray in King Kong. See how this young colony has advanced?
As they come to the last bell, amidst an old Bill from My Kind of Life and the rest very much out of it at this stage. And George Moore's letting old Bill have his head. He must win, but at the post it's My Kind of Life. It's a sensational victory for My Kind of Life.
Well, that's not my kind of life, mate.
And after that over from Tony Locke, it seems apparent to me, Richie, that the wicket's not taking spin. What would you say? Most definitely, Lindsay. It's apparent that the wicket is not taking spin.
I'm not taking any more of that.
He's going on to win yet another Open 1500 metres championship. 8 years old, Glennis Plowhite from Woolloomooloo, doing it again.
8 years old? 8 years old? What a place to live in. They're all sport mad. Swimming at 8 years old? I hadn't had my first bath at that age. Well, there's no escape from sport in this place. They're at it from dawn till dusk. You can't get any sense out of that infernal machine. Let's see if there's anything in the newspapers. Wait a minute. Here we are. That's more like it. Look at those headlines. General command under review. Old Monty's at it again, eh? There's no stopping him stirring him up in Whitehall again. He'll never hang up his beret. Let's see. General command under review. What's this? New Zealand mayor review became favorite over general command for the Eclipse States. Oh, it's all too much. What is a man to do? Here am I, a scholar who can't carry on an intellectual conversation unless I go into full athletic training for 6 months. Bounding and leaping and jumping about all over the place. I stand still just so long as it takes to get the result of the last race. I came over here to try to introduce a little culture. I'm no Billy Graham. My message needs the intimacy of the Parisian Left Bank Cafe Society. And I don't go much on always wearing shorts in public. There's a time and place for everything. What a man does in the privacy of his own chambers is up to him. But flaunting himself in public, this depravity must cease. And I suppose old Dr. Livingstone had his setbacks. Stanley, for example. We missionaries must persevere. Oh, if only there was a mental Olympic Games. I'll say one thing about all that cavorting about. It gives a man an appetite. Dear, dear. I bet that old Flynn couldn't have hacked his way through this lot single-handed. I bet Godfrey Wynne doesn't do his own washing up either. Ah, decisions, decisions. What shall it be?
Fruity Flakes, energy packed, vitamin enriched, as eaten by world champions.
Or perhaps, soft to the tongue, sun-kissed, tasty pasties for men. I can't see myself going three rounds with Cassius Clay on a bowl full of this stuff. Oh, no. I've got the giraffe again. I've got three of these already. Why can't I get the packet with the hippopotamus in? Oh. That hasn't gone off. I'd like to see Houdini get out of one of these. He'd have curdled and turned into yogurt. Now, let's see. Light blue touch paper and retard... No, 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 no. Pull here to form spout. Bend... Well, hang on. Bend well back. Pull apart. Fat lot of use you are. Pity you weren't a cat. Oh, well, I suppose this means another hard-boiled egg. I don't know, it's about time for a change. I think I'll have it soft-boiled. Now, how do you cook a soft-boiled egg? Funny how you get into a routine and it's hard to break. I bet Mrs. Beaton had the same trouble. Now, where's my cookbook? Look at this. Let's see. After yesterday's grueling, action-packed, bruising marathon at Dunster Park, it looks as if the Honourable Mildred Braithwaite will retain her World Championship croquet title. She will she? What on earth possessed me to keep that? Oh, it's on the back. Yes, of course. Oh, pheasant and Nureyev. Right. Take half a bottle of cognac. Add a quarter bottle of Drambuie and throw in some kirsch. I don't know about the pheasant. I think I'll settle for the gravy. No, it's a bit heavy for this time of the day. There's something else you can do with eggs. Let's have a look at Mrs. Beaton for a minute. Where are we? Oh, yes. Eggnog. Egg shampoo. I want a change, but I'm not going to start a cooking revolution. Ah, hello, this looks within my means. Oeuf français. First, catch your egg. Place egg in a seasoned saucepan. Seasoned saucepan, take a pinch of sea salt. Add some cayenne pepper. Formidable. A twist of vinegar. Just a soupçon. It was a good year. Add water gently. Oh.
a low oven?
A low oven? No, I think I'll cheat. I'll use the top. There's no doubt about the French. They may not be able to control their own destinies. But give them a bottle of cochineal and a cucumber, and there's no hope of them. Well, there's nothing else for it. I knew I had to face it sometime. Into the sink. Curry? Don't remember having curry. Must have been curried boiled egg. Yes, I really should eat out more. Mustn't waste water. Use Star detergent. Used by 9 out of 10 of Hollywood stars. I'd just like to see John Wayne doing the washing up. Sums it up, really. It's a matter of attitudes. In France, this is a delicacy. Over here, they turn it into a 100-yard race. A bit of chewing gum on the spoon. I bet they haven't bubbled that one.
Just a hard-boiled egg.
Well, that's enough exercise for me for one day.
Morning. Or should I say afternoon?
What day is it?
Saturday, mate. Milk bill.
Oh, yeah, just a minute. This. Owing to your behavior at the party last night, I'm changing my phone number. Max. Max? I've never heard of him.
Hey, get a move on, mate. The big game's on this afternoon.
Yes, I bet it is. Well, you can come in and help with the big search, because I can't find my money.
Oh, yeah?
No, honestly. I'm the most disorganized person on earth. That's what comes of being an intellectual. Your mind's on bigger things.
You've got something big to think about right there. What you need is a workout. Take care of the body and the mind will look after itself.
I mean, take a good look at yourself.
Well, I must admit, it is some time since I broke 4 minutes. Long before Roger Bannister thought about it, of course.
You're a miler?
Well, no, but the 50-yard dash to the bus stop, everybody said I was very promising.
I keep myself in shape running on my milk round. Why don't you do what I do?
I have no intention, my dear sir, of delivering milk at my time of life. Now, where could I have put that? This is ridiculous. Oh, perhaps in here. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I wonder what I put it in the toaster this morning.
You know, what you need is a set routine of exercises. It's all down to regularity. Take 5 minutes a day and before long you'll be as fit as I am. You want to start with something simple, like skipping. Little bag. Here we go. It's a great thing.
I'm sure it is. The best thing I can do is to stop drinking milk.
Here we go. You have a go, Neil.
Oh, yeah?
Now, gently to start with, and then a few quick ones.
Right.
Hang on, I'll get the bag up.
Yeah, right. It's fun, isn't it? It's like riding a bike after 20 years. You never quite lose your touch. Just a minute.
Now, do it to my count.
Wait a minute. Right.
Here we go. A what?
Strength. That's one good thing. At least we found the money. All right, I'll Well, that's that fixed up, okay? I won't delay you any longer.
Oh, I'm just getting warmed up. Come on now, running on the spot. Hop, one, two, three. Hop, one, two, three. Got these exercises from the Royal Canadian Air Force manual.
You just give me another reason for 18 flying.
Oh, don't be silly. These exercises were thought up for men just like you. I mean, how do you expect to win friends in this country if you're not in peak condition? A man here needs a sport.
Can I get by with chess?
Get yourself a real sport. A good club, and you're away.
Yeah, perhaps you're right. I could infiltrate my own theories and turn the whole nation over to my way of thinking. How many of these do you think I ought to do?
You just keep that up till I get back.
You won't be long. You will come back.
Yeah, and the place just outside the door. What you could do with is a real good workout on the weights.
How Ron Clark keeps up this for 3 miles at a time, I do not know. And what's the point of it all?
On your feet, no slacking there. It wasn't the spirit that won the Battle of Britain, I bet.
Not so sure of that. They also served who stood and stared.
Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now you.
Deceptive things, these milk crates, aren't they? Yes, well, you'll be wanting to get away to the match, I suppose.
Yeah, I suppose I had better be going. Hey, listen. What are you doing this afternoon?
Oh, just pondering over a few equations, delving into Plato, a light mental workout, nothing serious.
Ah, too much of that sort of stuff and you're going in a twist. Listen, why don't you come down with me and I'll show you how we spend a real Australian sporting afternoon.
I suppose a change of scene, get a bit of fresh air in my lungs, and who knows, today can be the start of an intellectual revolution. Hang on, I'll just go and fling a few clothes on.
Hey, fellas, like to meet Tony. That's Ken, Pete, and Herbie.
There you go.
Hello, mate.
Tony's over from England. I thought I'd show him how he spent a Saturday afternoon.
Of course, you chaps are world-renowned as sportsmen.
Well, it's something to be expected, but with all this sunshine and nourishing food, 6 schooners, love.
Permit me. Ah, put it away.
There'll be plenty of opportunity for that later, mate.
Ah, well, who's going to win the big one this afternoon, mate?
Which one do you mean? The racing, the cricket, the football, the tennis, the swimming, the surfing, or the trampoline?
You got a wider knowledge of sport than I thought.
Well, I like to keep up with television, read the newspapers.
Here we go.
Ah,
that's up there.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Bet you don't get beer like this where you come from.
Say that again.
Well, chaps, here's to the mighty Blues.
Eight alive.
May the best team win.
Same again, love.
That was very nice. Very nice indeed. Well, I suppose I'd all be getting ready to punish the leather spheroid. How far's the ground from here?
It's only about half a mile down the road.
Oh, we'd better get a cab then.
What for?
The match.
Oh, we're not going there.
Well, what's all this business about fresh air in my lungs?
This place is air-conditioned.
Well, what's all this talk about physical fitness?
You're talking to some of the best developed bicep men in the business.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. I suppose you English blokes get much of a chance to play sport, huh?
He said he was a 4-minuter.
Yeah.
There you are. Get a few pounds off him. He would have made a good forward.
Yeah. What do you mean, Wood? There weren't many people who tangle with me.
Ah, it brings it all back. The roar of the crowd. A sting of the liniment. A nervous tension as you led the team onto the field. because I would have tossed for England that year if I hadn't dislocated my thumb.
Yeah, well, I'm a racing man myself.
Yeah, of course, the sport of kings.
Yeah. Dad wanted me to be a jockey, but I couldn't make the weight.
I must say, I never found it a handicap.
Were you a gentleman rider?
Well, I certainly wasn't a lady rider.
Yeah, are you serious, you know, about your weight?
Oh, yeah.
How many rides did you have?
Oh, I was in constant demand. Many an owner was prepared to sacrifice a few pounds to get a rider of my calibre. When you're bidding for the blue ribbons of the turf, a stone here or there is a small price to pay.
Gee, I would have loved to have seen you race.
Oh, you should have been there. Royal Ascot. The bookies shouting the odds. The ladies in their hats all wishing me bonne chance. A dramatic hush as we came under starter's orders. I thought I might have a go at the Melbourne Cup while I was out here. But you know, for the life of me, I can't find my whip.
Well, you being an Englishman, mate, I thought you'd play a more refined sport, something like polo.
Yes, I was forced into an early retirement. It was either that or the Tower. He's a poor loser, you know.
Yeah, well, I can understand that. But there's more other sports for the aristocrat.
Yes.
What other sports did you play?
Well, I had a bash at, what's that game called? The one where you hit one ball against the other and,
Golf,
that's right, yes. The Royal and Ancient, they couldn't keep me away, rain or shine. Knew that course like the back of my hand. Now, it was the Open of 58, or was it 59? There were so many.
My word, there's a lot of money to be picked up in big-time golf.
Yes, you're right. 10 bob a round, plus your tips.
Well, cheers.
Yeah. All this rubbish about big-time sport, being a jockey and playing golf. Well, some athlete you are. You even have to put your glass down between drinks.
That's on account of my thumb, you see that? Harold Larwood did that in a game of French cricket for charity.
Oh, I thought you got that playing football.
I trust you're not picking on a man's disabilities to ridicule him.
Not when there's so much else to pick on.
Well, of course, with you, there's not much to pick on. There's not much of you at all, is there? Which I suppose, in a way, is a blessing to mankind.
Yeah?
Yeah. Look, you better warn him. He's going to get a right punch up the bracket.
Oh, Irby can look after himself, all right. He was amateur bantamweight champion.
Yeah, there always was.
Well, look, I haven't forgotten how, mate.
Hold me back. I shall do some damage. Hold me back.
Let me go. Let me go. I'll kill the mug.
Curb, bounder, card. Let me at him.
All right. Now, come on. Come on. Herbie, you should know better. You could kill him.
What? When I went in with Sugar Ray Robinson?
Oh, look, he's at it again.
Yeah.
If you're not careful, you'll have another fight on your hands with me. Nobody's paid for the last round of drinks yet.
Many of you may have missed the replay of yesterday's big game, so here is a third look at the match of the day from the sports stadium.
Oh, no, I went through all that yesterday. That's the sort of day I never want to go through again. I never want to hear about racehorses or tiddlywinks or boxing kangaroos as long as I live. I would prefer to stay a 97-pound weakling. It's the mind, not muscles, that really matter in this world. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, they didn't play for the All Blacks. And we're cast in the same mold. The only difference between us, really, is that they wore a sheet and I wear a dressing gown. They had no trouble making friends. They always had an ego group of students at their feet as they read out their latest theories. Yes, that's what I need. My own discussion group. I can see it now. The Hancock set. Perhaps a few of my works hand-printed. A forum of prose and poetry. I'd ask round Patrick White, Sid Nolan. In fact, the whole of Australian culture. That's the best of being intelligent. You can learn from your mistakes. Yes. I'll find a good literary society. I could infiltrate my own theories and turn the whole nation over to my way of thinking. Let's see now. Wait a minute. C-I-T-I. Hmm? That's it.
This is more me. A city arts discussion group. Hello. Yes, this is Anthony Hancock. I'd like to pop round to your society this afternoon for a quick soiree. Rub shoulders with people like Shelley, Keats, Byron, Browning. It'll be good to be back among old friends. What? That is the City Arts Discussion Group. No meeting today? Well, why not, in heaven's name? They've all gone to the football.